Good morning, Bridge Community Church. Thank you again for joining us for this Sunday morning worship. I want to share two important announcements before we get started in the rest of the service. First of all, I want to share with you that May 24th will be reopening at Bridge Community Church. This will be what we call Phase 1, and I want to describe to you what Phase 1 of reopening looks like for us. Phase 1 will be for adults to start meeting again in community groups, small group settings. And so how we're going to work this out is if you are already connected to a community group prior to the break, you will return in connection with that group. Now, what we want each and every one of you to understand and realize is that each community group is getting back together in different ways. And one of the things that we're asking is that you do not meet in the house and that you meet in groups of 10 or less. And so each community group has figured out their timeline of when they're starting that, how they're going to do that. Many groups are going to be meeting here at the church in sanitized rooms that are plenty spacious. When I say sanitized rooms, I'm talking about the sanctuary that I'm in right now will be where a community group will meet, and that will give plenty of distance socially for each and every one of them to be able to come and feel comfortable being here. The meetings will only be for an hour. There will not be any food and no bathroom breaks unless an emergency, and we're asking that those groups will come and meet. So if your community group's more than 10, their plan is to possibly break into two different groups during that time period. So again, community group leaders will have a plan for their group. Please be in touch with your community group leader. I'm assuming and I believe your groups will be group leaders will be in touch with you. Some groups are not meeting yet, but they are meeting by Zoom or some type of other communication. So please reconnect, and we encourage you to be a part of that community group again if you feel comfortable. Let me stress this. If you are not ready to come back in person and meet with people in person, please do not feel obligated. We want you to come at your pace that you feel comfortable with. You're not sinning against God. We're not going to be frustrated with you. We want you to come at the timetable that you are most comfortable with. There is going to be no judgment whatsoever about your personal preference when it comes to your health and your being comfortable in the settings. We're simply realizing that many of us are at a point that we are ready to get back together in small groups, so we're attempting that in a very safe environment. So again, not going into homes, only outside venues or meeting at the church, and each community group has a plan for that. There may be a group or two that are not meeting yet, but they will be meeting in a few weeks. So again, leaders will be in touch with you, and group members, get in touch with them so that you can know the plan, and this will all kick off May 24th. If you're an adult and you're saying, well, I'm not in a community group. Well, we know that in our worship service settings, there's almost 40 adults that are not connected to a community group that come to our Sunday morning worship services. And we want you to know, we would love for you to come be a part of one of those small groups if you would like, whether it be a group that's on Zoom and you participate with them, or whether it be one of our groups that are meeting here at the church. You are more than welcome to come and be a part of that, and you will hear information through our website and our weekly email about what groups are available for visitors to come and be a part of. There'll be a kind of a sign-in or a call to let us know you're coming. That way we know that we're keeping 10 or less in each group for each night. But we, again, would love to have you come. If you're not connected with one, this is a great time to get connected with one, whether it be by Zoom or whether it be in person at the church in one of those small groups. Okay? Some would ask this question, why are we not starting out with a worship service first? Again, our priority as a church is to move smaller, then gradually go to larger. And so because small groups, community groups are our heartbeat, we wanted to get back to those being the first thing that we implemented. Some will say, well, why aren't we doing anything for students and children yet? Based on the survey we did with the church and just dialogue with our leadership council, we want to make sure we have our children and our students' protection in mind. And so we're going to start out with the adults first and gradually move our way into corporate worship service. And then sometime after corporate worship services, we'll look at the possibility of our teenagers and our children coming back in some type of program. But until then, we feel starting with our adults, letting them kind of come back together and be a part of the body of Christ and communicate and interact with one another in person is the appropriate step for our congregation to go in. And if you're a parent, this is our model that we see biblically. you are the primary discipler in your child's life. We're to be a reinforcement in that. So we see it as a priority to get back in your life and help reinforce your life so that you can be encouraged and continue to help your child in your home as God designed it through his word. So again, thank you for your patience. Thank you for your prayers. We are sending an email out at the end of this week as well that kind of explains big picture what we're thinking as a church and leadership and how we move forward through these phases. We welcome your input from that. And we are looking forward to one day us getting back together as we were prior to the break. But my prayer is that there'll be more of a fervency. And the thing that will not be normal is that there'll be a deeper desire and a longing to want to be back together from this break. So I'm looking forward to that day. And just continue to pray for us as we wait on God's timing with this process. A second announcement that I want to give is to our graduating seniors. God has blessed us with seven students and their families who have partnered with us over at least this past year, and if not longer, for several years in this church. And their senior or this graduate, they are now graduating. And seniors, I want to say that I understand this is a very unique time and that many of you might be saddened about how this has kind of unfolded in your life. I want you to know that your God is still so kind and still so loving to you and is affectionate to you in every way. And even though the circumstances may have not lined up the way that you had planned out, God has a glorious plan that he wants to continue to let you be a part of. And so continue to follow the agenda and the plan for his life in your life. It's his life in your life that my prayer is that you'll grab hold of and make the agenda of God your agenda over this next few months and over the rest of your life. And we're here for you, and we're excited about this big mile marker in your life of graduating from high school and moving into your new phase, a new chapter in your life. And we want you to know the Bridge community, your home church, is here with you as you begin that process. We love you, and we're going to now move into a time of prayer. And right after prayer, you're going to watch a video that just gives a little honor and recognition to our seniors. And so please enjoy this video, and then Darren will come behind them and lead us in some songs of worship and then the message. So again, glad to have everyone here. Seniors, we love you. Let me pray. Father God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this day. And we ask, Lord Jesus, that you will, again, penetrate our hearts where we are in our homes, and God, bring us closer to you. God, I thank you that you're allowing us to kind of move back forward in some type of interpersonal dynamic where we're able to see each other in person, God. We pray for your protection and wisdom and guidance in that, Lord, as other churches are doing the same thing. Lord, we pray for our seniors, and Lord, we thank you for what you have done in their life and allow them to get to this point. God, may they truly put you first in every aspect of their life as they move forward. Lord, it's in your name that we pray, for we want you to get the glory out of our lives. Amen.
Empty hands held high, such small sacrifice. If not joined with my life, I sing in vain tonight. May the words I and feet.
Morning, church. Bridge, how we doing? Hope you're doing well. Thank you again this week for tuning in. I hope that you're pressing on. Come on, let's lift our eyes to God. He's worthy of our praise. We join the hymn of our redemption this morning as we sing this song. So come on. Worthy of our praise.
We join the hymn of our redemption. We raise a banner for the King. Our golden crowns, we lay them down for thee.
That's right.
So we shout from the depths of our redeemed lungs for the blood that you shed as our ransom. Oh, hear the sound, heaven shake, be exalted, O King of glory, overflow.
Come on, we sing.
Almighty God, forever you reign. We worship you, for even the grave you overcome. We magnify your people, rejoice with hands held high, forever. What kind of judge would leave his chambers?
Only one.
To pardon prodigals and thieves. With a crown of thorns, the veil was torn for me.
Yes, our response. Come on.
So we shout from the depths of our redeemed lungs for the blood that you shed as our ransom. Oh, hear the sound, heaven shake, be exalted, O King of glory, overflow. Almighty God, your people rejoice.
Worship you, God.
We magnify your people, rejoice with hands held high, for every sin you overcome. Your people cry holy, your people cry holy.
We join with heaven. Come on.
Your people cry holy, holy, holy. There is no end Oh, your people cry, holy. Yes, you are. Your people cry, holy. There's no one like you, God. Oh, your people cry, holy, holy, holy. There is no end. Oh, your people cry, holy. Your people cry, holy. Oh, your people cry, holy, holy, holy. There is no end. No, there is no end. Almighty God, forever you reign. We worship you, for even the grave you hold.
Church, just give the Lord praise where you are.
Oh, this we know, we will see the enemy run. This we know, we will see the victory come. We hold on to every promise you've ever made. Oh, Jesus, you are unfailing. You are who you say you are.
That's right.
And you'll do what you say you'll do. You'll be who you've always been to us, Jesus. Our hope is in you alone. Our strength in your mighty name. Our peace in the darkest day remains. Oh, Jesus.
Come on, we sing this we know.
Oh, this we know. We will see the enemy run. This we know. We will see the victory come. We hold on to every promise you've ever made. Oh, Jesus, you are unfailing. Our God, through the wilderness, our joy in the heaviness. Oh, you are our way when there seems there is no way, Jesus. Oh, this we know, we will see the enemy run. Oh, this we know, we will see the victory come. We hold on to every promise you've ever made. Oh, Jesus, you are unfailing. We trust you. We trust you. Your ways are higher than our own. We trust you. We trust you. Your ways higher than our own.
Come on, we say, we trust you. We trust you. Yes, your ways are higher than our own, we believe. Oh, we trust you. Yeah, Jesus, we trust you. Oh, your ways are higher than our own. Oh, this we know, we will see the enemy run. Oh, this we know, we will see the victory come. We hold on to every promise you've ever made. Trust you, your ways are higher than our own. We trust you, we trust you. Your ways are higher than our own. Well, church, that's what we're singing about. Okay, when we say we trust you, your ways are higher than our own. I think we see that in Psalm 20. It says, some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the Lord our God. There's so many things that we place our trust and our confidence in. And especially during times like this, in change, in uncertainty, in difficulty, in times that are just different. We all like routine. And we need routine to a certain extent. But during times like these, we find things that we place our trust in and we run to other names and other things rather than our God. But we want to sing this morning. We want to run to Jesus, our Savior.
Oh, in Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, oh, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Oh, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Ooh. Light of the world by darkness lay, but then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his and he is mine. I'm bought with the precious blood of Christ. Ooh. Thank you, Lord. Oh, oh, oh. No guilt in life, no fear in death, for this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, yet Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, yeah, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Just there in your home, would you just take a minute just to offer your thanksgiving to the Lord for what he's done for you? You know, thanksgiving is thanking God for what he's done. Would you just take a minute to do that, maybe as a family, as an individual? Lord, I'm reminded of Psalm 8. It says, when I look at the stars, the moon and the stars which you set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him? God, that you would choose to think about us. And it says that you crowned us with glory and honor. God, who are we? That we would be made in your image. So Lord, we just pour out our praise before you, God, our thanksgiving. God, we love you. We thank you so much for showing us mercy and for proving to us and defining what love is. God, love is not what we see. Love is not what we feel. It's sacrifice. It's choice. Father, we just thank you that you showed us the greatest love possible, sending your son Jesus to take our place upon a cross, take the sin and the shame, the punishment that we deserved, yet you poured it on your son. God, we pour out our thanksgiving to you. God, we give you praise. It's the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
All right, if you can take your Bibles now and turn to the book of Psalms, Psalms 110. 110 is where we're going to be today, and the title of my sermon is The Reign of Jesus in My Life. Psalms 110, The Reign of Jesus in My Life. Let me kind of give you, first of all, some background about Psalms 110. I just want to share this out of my notes here. This chapter represents one of the most glorifying descriptions of Jesus' reign as king and priest. Not many times do you see the connection, but you see it here in this passage in God's Word, where it is pointing to the future king coming that will reign on the throne forever, but it also gives a picture in the same chapter of this same king also being priest. And that was a unique thing about the future Messiah, not only because in the Jewish mindset, there was a king, and then there was also priests that offered offerings up to the Lord. But in the future Messiah that would come, Jesus himself, he would not only be one of them, he would be both of them, king and priest. And this chapter speaks to that. It declares Christ's current role in heaven as the resurrected Savior and his future role on earth as the reigning ruler. This chapter is also a glimpse into the millennial reign of Christ that John testifies to in Revelation chapter 20, verses 1 through 6. If you're a new believer, a new student of God's Word, you may not be familiar with the millennial reign, and this is talking about the end of times and when God will come and reign for 1,000 years on the earth. And so John testifies to that in Revelation 20, verses 1 through 6. Many biblical scholars, this is the area that there's a lot of different interpretation of what the millennial reign will look like. But what we do know for certain is that it is going to be a point in time that God institutes and that is going to be experienced in human history. And John records it in Revelation chapter 20, verses 1 through 6, and Psalms 110 alludes to it. Let me share with you out of Revelation 1 through 6, just to let you understand where it's spoken about the millennial reign of Christ. Revelation 20, verses 1 through 6 says, "Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, holding in his hand the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain. And he seized the dragon, the ancient serpent, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years and threw him into the pit and shut it and sealed it over him so that he may not deceive the nations any longer until the 1,000 years were ended. And after that, he must be released for a little while. Then I saw thrones, and seated on them were those to whom the authority to judge was committed. Also, I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for the testimony of Jesus and for the word of God, and those who had not worshipped the beast or its image and had not received its mark on their foreheads or their hands. They came to life and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years was ended. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is the one who shares in the first resurrection. Over such, the second death has no power, but they will be priests of God and Christ, and they will reign. They'll be priests of God and of Christ, and they will reign with him for 1,000 years. So the millennial reign is about 1,000 years, and some wonder in Revelations, is this kind of more of an illustration that it's a true thing, but is it a literal 1,000 years? And some will say, will this come after the return of Christ, or does it come before the return of Christ? Bottom line, where we're jumping in today, we won't have time to dive into this area, but what I do want you to know is that this is going to be a point in history that God institutes, and it magnifies God's glory and how he reigns and rules and has authority over everything. And Psalms 110 alludes to that as we will look at it today. Next thing that I want you to see out of this background is that, like Psalms 118, Psalms 110 is the most quoted psalm in the New Testament. This and Psalms 118 have the most references in the New Testament scripture. And Peter even used the first verse kind of as his beginning to his punchline when he declared Jesus is Lord and Christ at his great sermon that he gave at Pentecost, where over 3,000 people gave their life to Christ. This is the this is the chapter that first verse came from that Peter echoed. We'll actually study that in another week from now, Lord willing, when we get back into Acts chapter 2. So anyway, Psalms 110 may not be familiar, like Psalms 23 is to you, or another Psalms that you memorized, but it has many, many references in the New Testament and speaks about the rule and reign of this great leader to come, who we know as Jesus Christ, our Lord. So let's dive into it by reading the passage of Scripture, Psalms 110, and just follow with me as I read. Verse 1 says, "The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter. Rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people will offer themselves freely on the day of your power in holy garments. From the womb of the morning, the dew of your youth will be yours. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. The Lord is at your right hand. He will shatter kings on the day of his wrath. He will execute judgment among the nations, filling them with corpses. He will shatter chiefs over the wide earth. He will drink from the brook by the way. Therefore, he will lift up his head." Let's pray. Father God, as we begin to study your word now and what this chapter means for our life, Lord Jesus, may we be humbled to have a teachable heart. Lord, may we be committed to wanting to put application and feet to it, Lord, and be a doer of your word. Because, Lord, again, we do want you to get the glory out of our life because you deserve it, Lord Jesus. You are the lover of our soul. You are the king above all kings. And you are the beginning and the end. And so, Lord, all our hope is in you. And therefore, we want our lives to speak to that. So, Lord, bless us now as we study in your word. It's in your name we do pray. Amen. If you're trying to look at it a little bit more, as I look at this title again, the reign of Jesus Christ in our life, Psalms 110 also connects to Jesus' words in Mark chapter 1, verses 14 through 18. Jesus said after John was arrested that Jesus came into the cities proclaiming to them that the kingdom of God is at hand, therefore repent and believe. And then it goes on in the next verse to say he comes up to Andrew and Peter and he says to them, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. And verse 18 says they immediately dropped their nets and followed him. So this picture of the coming Messiah in Psalms 110, we see the life action of it happening in Jesus' ministry and time when he commanded and encouraged and challenged men to come and follow him. And so our prayer today and how we put skin on this and say, okay, what am I going to get out of it if this is talking about the future reign and rule of Christ? Well, let's go back to that connection of what is the kingdom of God? What does that phrase kingdom of heaven mean? A real simple definition that I use is that the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God, whenever you see that in God's word, what it's referring to is the rule and reign of God through his son, Jesus Christ, in our life and in the world. The rule and reign of God through his son, Jesus Christ, in our life and in the world. And again, some may say, well, I don't really see him reigning in the world. Here's the reality. When the day of the Lord comes, and we're going to see some of this at the end of these verses of this chapter, every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess Jesus as Lord. But friends, here is the beauty of the gospel. We as the church don't have to wait to the end of the day. Praise God. By his mercy, he has saved us and he has allowed you and I to come into his kingdom, not as just servants, but as sons of the living God, and he's letting us experiencing the rule and the reign of God now in our life. And so what we're about to see in Psalms 110, as it paints a picture of God's rule and reign through Jesus, we need to be applying it today as the church. How am I allowing this rule and reign of God to be evident in my life today? And so I've got 4 points for us to look at in that as we get started. So look back with me at Psalms 110, verse 1. It says, the Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. This is God, this is David, speaking about God, speaking to the future king that would come through David's line, that would reign forever. He said, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. David is alluding that there is a kindred close connection between the God, the one true God, and this future king. What we know of it is, it says God himself. God came to us in through the Son, Jesus Christ, and we got to know God in the flesh. And so when David peers and sees this future, he sees this perfect relationship between God the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ, Jesus being the one that would sit at the right hand of the Father to rule and to reign. And let's explain how it says he's going to reign. It says God the Father basically says to Jesus the Son, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. This was an illustration used back in their time that the people would get. Anytime another army or country was conquered, the one that was the conqueror would put his foot on the neck of the one that was conquered, and it would show total submission. And so if you can get the picture of a guy's foot being on the neck of another person, that neck was kind of the footstool for that conquering king. And God the Father saying to his Son Jesus, come now, sit with me at my right hand. And we know that when Jesus rose from the dead and ascended to God the Father, he's now sitting at the right hand of God the Father. And God is saying, sit here while I make your enemies your footstool. Basically, Jesus' foot on their neck as a sign of conquer, that it has been conquered and he is the victor. He is the victorious one. Hold on to that imagery. Verse 2 says, the Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter. Rule in the midst of your enemies. So it goes on to say, from the Mount Zion, and this is a picture again, I believe, back into the millennial reign, where it talks about you will actually rule with your scepter over your enemies, over the land at this time. So without getting lost in where Jesus is presently right now and where he will be in the future in this reign, let's bring it home a little bit more personal and talk about the rule and reign of the kingdom of God now. We have been blessed not to be the enemy of God anymore and to experience the rule and reign of God in the last days, but we have been blessed to be brought in as children of God. And so the rule and reign described here, there should be some parallel of how we apply it into our life. And so here's point number one for today. The reign of Jesus in my life is seen when I'm living a life of surrender to his will. God the Father said, sit here while I make your enemies your footstool. God was saying, as I begin the process of conquering and destroying every enemy and every stronghold that can go against my glory, sit here while I establish this. And when you think about it as a Christian, our salvation is a process. It has a glorious beginning. Praise God, it has even more of a glorious ending. But all in that middle is what we call the sanctification process, whereas God begins to save us and he's justified us by the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ. Our sins have been covered and covered by his righteousness. We begin to live in a relationship with the living God where he begins to take off the old life and put on this new life found in Christ. And so it's a sanctifying process. And so salvation is a process. It's more correct to say, not that I've been saved, but that I am continuing to be saved because we're in this glorious process where God will finish it, because it says what he began, he will be faithful to complete. He begins that work in our life. He continues it. And while he is working on us, different areas of deadness and things that were hostile to the word of God and to the nature of God, those sinful fleshly things are being weeded out of our life. And everything is coming under the command and lordship of Jesus Christ. So believer, if I'm saying that the kingdom of God is in my life right now and the rule and reign of Jesus Christ is happening, it should be seen and evident by a surrendered life. within me, there should be a picture of me constantly dying to things in my life that God doesn't want, and they are coming under His submission. I want you to ask yourself this question. If the process at this moment of salvation is a lifestyle of surrender, that means that we are in a constant state of repentance from the idols in our life that make us lose our focus in the Lord. So I want you to ask yourself this question today. What is the next area in your life that you have asked God to put His foot on your neck about? If you're saying, I'm a follower of God and I'm experiencing the reign of Christ right now, then that should be marked by a life of surrender. And as you continue in this glorious work of salvation until the day you see Him in heaven, there should be a constant taking off of the old fleshly life, the old habits, the old attitudes. And friends, repentance is not a one-time thing. Repentance should be a constant in our life if we are wanting to be right with God. And so I ask you this question again, brother. What does God need to put His foot on in your life? What part of the neck does His foot need to go on and stomp out and stamp out and say no more, because you belong to me? It's a great testimony in what our discipleship groups are going through right now. It's called How to Worship Jesus Christ. And there's a testimony by Archibald Brown. He was a great pastor and preacher in the day of Charles Spurgeon. And he had this testimony in his prayer time with God, where he asked Jesus, he said, Jesus, what, you can have anything in my life. And he kind of felt the Spirit of God come back over him and says, Archibald, I don't want anything, I want everything. The surrendered life is not a phrase of you can have anything. It is a surrendered life saying you have everything. Put your foot on my neck, Lord, and weed out all the sinful fleshliness that you do not want, because I belong to you and I have power to walk away from any of these sinful strongholds. So church, what's the encouragement I want to give you today? Friends, if there's something in your life that's entangling you, some fleshly, sinful nature that's getting your focus off the Lord, that's making you lose your passion, praise God, Jesus is on His throne, and He is an authority of all things, and He's already done the work of salvation in your life. He's already conquered death, and if He's conquered death, friends, He can conquer that area. So let Him put the foot on your neck and let Him stamp it out of your life. Repentance is not a repercussion or a sign of rejection. Repentance is an invitation to bring back restoration in your life, to be fresh again. Let God stamp it out. For everything that's an enemy of Him is coming to be a footstool now in this process. And He's already saved you, brother. You've already given your life. So let Him have that closet in your room of your heart. Let Him have that chamber, that secret that no one else sees. Let Him have it, because if you say God has the reign and rule of my life, it'll be evident by you not saying, well, you can have this now or this. It's by you saying, you can have everything. So whatever you're seeing, stomp it out. Have your lordship over. Point number one, the reign of Jesus in my life is seen when I'm living a life surrendered to His will. John 15, 1 and 2 says, I am the true vine, says Jesus, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, He takes away, and every branch that does bear fruit, He prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Friends, when God points out an area of your life to give to Him, it is not in a pursuit of punishment. It is a pruning process saying, I want more of me showing. And that is what's going to give you contentment. That's what's going to give you peace, is you having more of me. So let me have more of you. Not just anything, everything. Let's move on to the next point. Verse 3. Your people will offer themselves freely on the day of your power. In holy garments from the womb of the morning, the dew of your youth will be yours. Again, David's seeing a picture into the future And I believe he's looking at this millennial reign and he's saying, your people, there will be a willing heart on their lives. They will be dressed in holy garments, totally devoted to you during this time period. You will have the freshness and you will have them fervent and excited about being followers of you. This brings up the next point in our life. If God has rule and reign now, it will be seen in this next point. Point number two. The reign of Jesus in my life is seen by my willingness and preparation for God's will. If the reign of God is truly evident in my life, you will see an attitude of willingness and you'll see a heart preparing itself for the agenda and will of God in their life. If you're having trouble finding, I wrote this down, I want to say this to you. If you're having trouble finding what part of your neck God needs to put his foot on, what is that area that he needs to stomp out and remove? And if you're like, Chris, I'm praying about that and I don't really know what area it is, then this is the area I want you to think about. Maybe you need to look at the attitude of your heart towards him and your willingness to follow him. It's one thing to surrender because you don't have any other choice. It's another thing when you have all the choices, but you don't want to surrender. There's still an unwillingness in your heart. So I ask you to pray about your attitude. It may not be an action as much as it is an attitude. It might be, oh, you can do this, but don't do this in anticipation, trying to be like you can manage God or something like that. But the reality is your attitude's raunchy because you're like, God, I will give you some things, but not this thing, so you better not take this from me. So if you're saying, Chris, I can't think of this area that God needs to stamp out right now, how's your attitude towards the will of God in your life? How is your attitude about him interrupting your life and saying, this is how I want you to worship me? Is there a desire for the things of God? Or are you saying, no, everything's going good right now. So as long as they stay that way, me and God are fine. What if things were not going good? Would there still be a desire for God? I might be talking to you today and things are going really bad right now. Circumstances that God has allowed are going pretty bad. And so I'm going to ask you this question, and you may not like it, but let me go ahead and share it with you. If you're going through a tough right time right now and circumstances are not going the way you want to, how is your worship to the Lord during these circumstances? How is your attitude towards God during these circumstances? Psalms 37:4 says, delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. The object of our affection cannot be ourselves. In our worship of God, if our attitude and purpose is so that we can be happier with self, then we're never going to be worshiping God. Because if our purpose in worshiping God is saying, oh, so that I can be happy, I'm going to worship God, then that truly, God's not the object of our affection. In that moment, we're still the object of our affection, and we're just using God to get us to what we want in our happiness. Psalms 37:4 says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. So it's not, I have these desires, let me worship the Lord so I can fulfill my desires. It's saying that I take all that my desires are, and I put them to the side because I am going to truly worship the Lord. And some of you may be robbed of your joy right now because whether you realize it or not, God's allowed this testing in your life. Why might have he done this in your life? Why have he maybe in some way said, hey, here's a circumstance that you're not going to be real happy with that I put you in, but I still want you to honor me in it. Why might he be doing that? Because he might be pruning you to make sure that all your affection is to worship him. Worship is not when I feel like singing. Worship is when I sing because I am convinced he is worthy to be sung to. Worship is not when I feel like singing. Worship happens when I sing because I am convinced he is worthy to be sung to. Worship is not a song I choose, but it is a sacrifice that he asks of me. Friends, you do not choose the method in which you worship God. God chooses that. And what we see all the way back to Psalms 110, when we see the future reign of Christ and his kingdom, we see a people who are offering themselves freely in holy garments. We see a people of God who are willingly saying, God, I want to be a part of what you're doing. And they're not doing it because they have something in mind for themselves. The object of their affection is God himself. You can look back at this in Revelation chapter 4 when we see a picture in heaven of all the elders worshiping God. And it says when the Lamb comes and they sing that they fall on the ground and they bow before him in submission. And those 24 elders that were on their own thrones, they take their crowns off and they cast them to the side. They take their own thrones and they cast their crowns to the side. Why do they do this? Because they do not want one ounce of glory going to them. They want the glory going to God. Psalms 110 is saying the picture of his perfect rule and reign is from a people that are willing to be used by God, willing to serve God, and they're prepared with their holy garments. And so when I'm saying a willing heart starts with making sure that God truly is the object of your affection when you worship him. Many of us are robbing ourselves of personal worship time because we are focused on the method in which God has told us to worship instead of the object in which we need to be worshiping. We don't like how God's saying, serve me now. We don't like the people God may be telling us to serve. And therefore, our raunchy attitude really means that we're still king of our throne and that we only worship God so that we can benefit ourselves. Friends, that's not true worship. True, pure worship is willing servants, realizing that God has rule and reign to use them however he wants to. And just like in Abraham's time, when he told Abraham, this is how you will worship me, sacrifice your son. You don't choose the method of worship. You just get the opportunity to do it. And be a part of it. And just like Abraham, no matter how hard it is, God knows the point that he stretches you. And friends, if you will trust him in this journey that he's asking you to trust him in this song of worship that he's asking you to walk him in, if you will trust him, you will walk away like Abraham, giving a new name to God because you know him in a more intimate way than you did before. We're not worshiping just because we sing a song about God. We're worshiping him when we sing a song because we're convinced he is worthy of worship. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. That's the next thing I wanted you to see out of this verse. Your people will offer themselves freely on the day of your power in holy garments. They were prepared. These people were dressed. They were dressed appropriately. They were prepared to be used by God. You're saying that God has rule and reign in your life right now. How's your willingness towards him? And how is your preparation towards him? Because in the day that we see it perfectly, we see a people that are wearing holy garments. That means that they've not only cast off the things that are unholy, but they've pursued the things that are holy, and they put those things upon their life. Friends, some of us, if we want to see the rule and reign of God more evident in our life, we have got to pray for that to happen. These last couple of weeks, I feel like God is personally, each week, he's showing another ugly aspect of my life that he is asking me to repent and give over to him for his glory. This week, it was this thought when I was reading in Revelation chapter 4 and I was seeing the elders cast their crowns to the side. The Holy Spirit quickened my heart to say, Chris, are you truly satisfied if I get 100% of the glory out of your life? And friends, I have to be honest with you. There's a part of me that just wants 1%. There's a part of me that wants to get some nudge of gratitude or expression of notice with this life. So am I prepared for God to use me in any capacity that he wants? Not according to that attitude. Not if there's 1% of me that is still saying, I want to get some type of man-made recognition for it. What if that recognition that I want to get is not popular? What if that recognition that I get is rejection from this world? I can't just have the good stuff and not be willing to embrace what my master and savior had to go through in his suffering when he got rejected by everyone. And as I've been praying and asking God to do a work in my heart, I'm seeing ugly things. Things that, yeah, I want to bow to God first, but do I really want to throw my crown away? Do I really want God to have all the glory in my life? And friends, to be honest with you, I'm not there yet. Well, then, Pastor, what do you do with that? I pray. I pray and I beg God to do what only God can do in my life. Lord, will you have the glory, 100% glory, out of my life? You don't have it yet. Yes, I give you first, but God, you didn't want just want the first part of it. You wanted the whole thing. God, I want to give that to you. Help me, Lord, by the power of your Spirit, take this out of my hands so that you can get the glory. If we are a church that says we want the rule and reign of God, then what it is going to look like in Psalms 110 one day is what it needs to start looking like in our life right now. And that is that there's a willing attitude to worship him in whatever manner he wants, but there's also an attitude prepared for him to get all the glory for it. For he is the only one that's holy. And friends, you can't get holy without God preparing your heart. And so, church, what am I doing right now as I ask God to do a work in my life? I am just praying, asking God to do what only God can do. Rid me of the 1%. And friends, if I wanted to really be honest with you, it's not just 1%. There's some days I still want him to have the majority, but I still, can I have a third of it? Can I have 25%? Can I have 10%? And friends, when we focus on the calling of God, if we want him moving where he is holy and set apart, he has to have 100% of the glory. And we wonder why God's presence doesn't seem to be more evident in our community, in our country today. Because many of us, as Christians, if we're honest, we've gotten religious enough to give God the first part, but we want all the rest of it. And so, church, I want to ask you this again as a pastor. We have about 9 households praying with us right now during the week. We're not praying like community groups are praying, where we're praying for the needs of one another. We're praying for the greatest need, the one thing that we all need, and that's more of the glory of God to be evident in our life, in the life of our church. Because we don't have control over what's going on in the community, and we don't have control over what's going on in the other local churches, but what we can do can be a committed people of praying, God, would you prepare our hearts for your glory to come down here in the congregation of Bridge Community Church? And so forgive me if you took it as a guilt trip last week. That was not my intent. My intent is to invite you to join us in one of these weekly prayer groups. And if you say, Chris, I see him on the email, but I can't meet in those times, but I want to pray with you, then, brother, join us and open up another time so maybe some other people can come pray. And what are we praying for? It's not Aunt Betty's toe, and it's not for your personal need. It's for the glory of God in all of our lives. Can we be a people that begins to pray, God, I'm not there yet. I want 10% of the glory. Will you take that 10% out of my life? Would you join us in praying for the glory of God to reign in Bridge Community Church? Will you join us? Because I don't know any other way for him to have glory than for him to show up and get it himself. And so I am asking in faith for God to do that in my personal life, and I am asking my brothers and sisters to join me. That be our fervent prayer every time we meet together and we pray, and may it be a glorious work to see every day two or three gathered in the name of Christ for one specific request, for God to get the glory out of every aspect of what we do here at Bridge. For that's when the world and the community will see the rule and reign of God. That is when we're putting on our holy garments. This is when we can see it evident. And for, friends, it's for our taking. We don't have to wait to the end of time. We get to experience eternal life now. So let's don't rob ourselves of experiencing God where He gets all the bragging rights. Would you join me in that prayer? Point number three, the reign of Jesus in my life is seen in me following Jesus. The reign of Jesus in my life is seen in me following Jesus. Verse 4 says this, the Lord has sworn and will not change His mind. You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. This is God the Father speaking about the Lord Jesus Christ, saying, you will be a priest, not only a king forever, but you will be a priest forever. What is a priest? A priest was someone that was the mediator between God and man. He was the one that brought offerings on the behalf of man and helped them be in good status with God, because he would bring the offerings of the people towards God. In Hebrews chapter 5, verses 5 through 10, talk about this. It says, so also Christ did not exalt himself to be made a high priest, but was appointed by him who said to him, you are my son, today I have begotten you. As he says also in another place, you are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him, being designated by God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. You may be saying, well, who's this guy Melchizedek? Before the Mosaic Law and before all the priests came to the Levite family, there was a godly man named Melchizedek in the days of Abraham. And he was a worshiper and a priest to the Most High God. And Abraham, when he wanted to give an offering to God, he came to Melchizedek to give that offering. And Melchizedek blessed him in the name of the Lord on that day when he did that act of obedience. God's word is saying, hey, Jesus, David didn't come through the line of Levi. He came through a different family line, and Jesus was coming through David's line, but he's saying it doesn't mean that he's still not a priest. He's coming in the line of Melchizedek. Melchizedek was a priest before the Mosaic Law. Therefore, Jesus also was appointed by God and a priest before the Mosaic Law. Jesus has always reigned as priest, and he will reign forever as priest. And in verse 10, it says this again in Hebrews chapter 5. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him. Priests were a lifeline back in the Jewish time between God and the people. Friends, Jesus Christ is our lifeline to God. But the Word of God has made it clear, we only show the rule and reign of Jesus if we truly are following him. And that following him is through an act of obedience, where when he says, do this, we do it. We follow him because he is our lifeline. So point number three, if Jesus is reigning in my life right now, then it is seen by me following Jesus, me being obedient. Let me ask you this question. How do you know you're saved? How do you know that you have the hand of God upon your life? The only adequate answer is because you follow Jesus. Why is that the only adequate answer? Because that's the only answer that Jesus gives. Mark chapter 1, follow me. Peter and Andrew did not pray a prayer. They did not join a church. They dropped their nets and immediately followed the Lord. You see in the rest of the gospel different ways. Sometimes Jesus didn't say, follow me and go into another town with me. Sometimes he would heal someone and say, your faith has made you healed, and he would send them back to their hometown. So follow me also means following the instructions of God. And so the basic answer is this. Friends, how do I know I'm saved? Because there is a desire in my heart to be right with God through the Word of God and the instruction of God. And Jesus has spoken through His Holy Word. And if we are followers of Jesus, then we are following Jesus according to the Word of God. And there is a desire in our heart to be obedient to God. This is how we know we're saved. That there is a desire to be right with God. And we see how to be right with God through the Word of God. And we obey and we follow Him in that way. And some of you, that might rub you wrong, because the honest truth is you haven't read your Bible in a year. You haven't desired at all to ever even engage and be a student of the Word of God. And you're saying, well, are you saying I'm not saved because I don't read the Bible? I thought it's not a salvation of works. No, friends, it's a salvation that works. It flows through us. And if I'm experiencing Christ and I'm saying I want to be a follower of you, I've repented for myself and I want to follow you now, then what I'm crying out to is, what is your way? I want to know your way. And friends, God has showed us His way. We've got to pick it up and read it and ask the Holy Spirit to help us understand it so we can put it in action into our life. And friends, if you're saying today that convicts you because you haven't read the Word of God, maybe you are saved because you're convicted now. And so your salvation is proven by the fact that you're ready to become a student of the Word of God and follow the Word of God and be obedient to the Word of God. Because God said forever, Jesus will be our lifeline. Forever, He will be the priest. And whatever the priest instructs, therefore we follow. How do you know what to follow in His instructions if you don't read His Word? So again, you might be saved and hadn't read the Word of God in a year, but because what I've just shared with you has convicted your heart, friends, that conviction, if you're saved, will lead to action of repenting and getting back to following the way of God. Verse 5 through 7. The Lord is at your right hand. He will shatter kings on the day of His wrath. He will execute judgment among the nations, filling them with corpse. He will shatter chiefs over the wide earth. He will drink from the brook by the way. Therefore, He will lift up His head. These last three verses paint a picture of the day that Jesus will bring the final judgment upon the earth against all those who are not His children, all those who are godless, all those who are unholy, all those who are enemy of Christ. And basically it's saying because God's hand's over Him, because He's the anointed King and He is the anointed priest, He is going to have victory once again over His enemy. And verse 7 says, He will drink from the brook by the way, therefore He will lift up His head. That last statement speaks of a sign of contentment and peace, that He will complete what He started in that judgment, in that work. You're saying, well, Chris, how is this relevant to me today? Well, church, here's the good news of the gospel. The reign of Jesus in my life is seen by my gratitude for His unmerited love in my life. Verses 5 through 7, church, are not for you. Why? Not because of what you've done to earn some acceptance or some exception to the wrath, but because of what you have received, because of someone who has given it to you without you deserving it, without you earning it, because He has chosen to show favor and love you. This is the good news of the gospel. The kingdom of God is at hand, and Jesus has presented it to people who don't deserve it, people that deserve His wrath, but by His mercy He has chosen to give compassion and grace and forgiveness. And He is saying, this is not for you, church. This is actually for you. John 3, 16 through 18. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believed in Him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through Him. Whoever believes in Him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. This day of judgment in the rule and reign of Christ that is pictured in Psalms 110 is coming. But church, your judgment has been satisfied at the cross of Jesus because God so loved you that he gave you Jesus. And when Jesus said it was finished, he meant the judgment of God against your life was finished. Praise God. That verses 5 through 7 are not talking about your church. So in light of that mercy, in light of that grace, in light of the glorious truth about Jesus, what can you give back to him in gratitude this week? God's rule and reign is coming in the last days. But God's rule and reign has already begun in those who are being saved through Jesus Christ. So I want to go over these 4 points again. If I say that the rule and reign of Jesus is evident in my life, then point number one, it'll be seen by a surrendered life that is constantly asking him to stand on my neck and stomp out any fleshly nature that is not of you. If I desire and am showing the evidence of the rule and reign in Christ, point number two, then it'll be seen by my willingness to do whatever he asks because it's for him that I'm doing it for and my preparation for me to be ready to be used by God for his glory. The reign of Jesus in my life is seen by my willingness and preparation of God's will. Point number three. The reign of Jesus in my life is seen in me following Jesus. If he is my priest forever, he is my lifeline. Therefore, wherever he goes, I will follow and I will obey because that is the proof of salvation. Point number four, in light of the judgment coming, he has dismissed that judgment on me because he placed it on his son at Calvary, and therefore I am eternally grateful. And what can I do to offer my life back to him this week? These are the four attitudes and these are the four actions of a person who's experiencing the kingdom of God reigning in their life. Church, may it be the heartbeat and desire of Bridge Community to want to see this rule and reign now. Let me pray. Lord Jesus, do what you have to do in our life to where you get the complete glory from our life. And God, may you through that, our prayer will be answered, that people will know who you are, and that we'll have the greatest joy of being a part of pointing to you and bragging about you, because you could have judged us, but instead you adopted us so that we could brag and boast about your greatness, because we have experienced that greatness in our life, the beautiful, wonderful work of Jesus working in us. We love you for that. Amen.